Welcome to my studio in the Highlands of Scotland, from where we share with you this Elphen tutorial, showing how to paint Webstrand the Tooth Gatherer. In the first book of the Elphen Chronicles, the story was all about Lacewing and her swarm. And one of the illustrations for that book was about the three elfin warriors, Bloodsword, Serpentspear and Thunderaxe. And each of those had different coloured wings, and the light was glistening from the cells of those wings. And one of the most common questions I received from people who saw the painting or bought the book was, how did I create that transparency? Well, over the years, I have painted many elfin wings, and they come in many different shapes and sizes and different colours. And quite often, the way the light falls on them is different from painting to painting. But there are certain things which are common, and that if you start to understand how transparency and reflection works on the surface of one of those elfin wings, you too would be able to paint those elfin wings in any circumstance or in any sort of light. So in this particular study of Webstrand, which I hope that you will paint along with me, you will find that I've used as many of those different qualities as possible. In this box set of Elphen tutorials, I share with you the painting process that will enable you to work along with me in not only capturing Webstrand the Tooth Gatherer, but also her precious tooth gathering pouches and her elegant hands on which she wears her swarm leader's eye ring. I also show you how to depict her wings when fully opened. And finally, the forgettle dust and remembered dust shakers, which protect the elfin magic. And keep your eyes open for the glass mouse. My second book, in which I chronicle a most significant event in the life of Webstrand the Tooth Gatherer, tells of her meeting with the earthling Fizz and their journey to Shemistra. It's not just teeth that are carried in the tooth pouch. Sometimes there's something else. And this is another pair of seed pods from a particular plants on Shemistra, one called the forgettle nettle and the other called the remember rose. And as the name suggests, they help you either to remember or to forget. And the pollen from these particular plants plays a very important part in the story. So we're going to create those seed pods, to show you exactly what they look like. They do play an important part in the story. They're also illustrated all the way through the book at the end of each chapter because of their importance and because basically they're just very nice objects. So let's look at the seed pods for the forgettle and remember dust. Now these particular seed pods are quite small, so this area on my sketch pad will do very well for them. Again, it's up to you to find a nice little place for them, but they don't need to be too big. Remember, they fit within the tooth pouch, so they are quite small. I think we'll do one behind the other, and we'll have them have one standing and one sort of on its side. So we'll just position them first of all. We'll have one behind the other, as we did with the tooth pouch. They are symmetrical objects, so we can take a line through the middle of them, which will give them the lean of the object. That one is going to lean that way, and this one's going to be on its side, so the line through the center can go in that direction. Now what that means is that everything revolves around this line. So that little dome on the top, you can see both sides of that are the same, and the curve there is the same on both sides of this line, and therefore it's leaning to one side. This one coming forward here, so that a little dome on top is going to be coming towards us. You can see that it's the same on both sides there. And that also gives us a clue to the pattern across its surface, because we've got little gems going around the surface, and they're going towards the point at the bottom. So if you imagine this line going down to a point somewhere there, they're curving around towards that point. And so these ones, if you imagine a point somewhere there, curving around towards that point, flattening out as it comes towards this middle line. You see the curves flattening out and then curling more acutely as it moves away. And on the top here, there are some spiral gems, layers of gems. So across the top there, spiraling that way and that way and that way. And between each of those spirals, a little hole. And that hole is the hole through which is sprinkled either the remember dust or the forgettle dust. Now each one of these lines is going to become a line of gems, just as they are on the tooth pouch. So if you want to draw them in, you can do. I'm going to just leave them as lines for the moment, as I did on the pouch, and just put them in ink. But if you feel happier to put those all in now, do so by all means. The top of this, because it's a seed pod, it has a stalk, a little twisting stalk, and that's useful for attaching to, if Webstrand's not carrying it in her tooth pouch, she can hook it onto the top of her skirt there. So they've got a little curl on the top. And that is the remember dust and forgettle dust. And we're now going to turn those into an ink line. In episodes 1 to 4, in this 8 video box set, I show you how to paint Webstrand, perched on Fizz's bedpost as she addresses her gathering swarm. Once again, let's start at the top left. And this really is almost all little gems. The only thing is they're slightly different sizes and slightly different shapes. So the ones there, little round ones. And then as we move up these spirals, these are just a little bit slightly elongated. Like so. So I'm just using the very tip of the brush here to get these in. You can see why I said that it would be quite reasonable for you to draw these in pencil, if you preferred. And these holes are, you see, they're slightly elongated because they're going up this domed shape. These stems at the top they don't always conform, because they're not something that's been manufactured. They are the stem of the seed pod. Now, the ones coming down here are more like teardrops, and they're slightly larger. So they are bigger, the larger at the bottom, thinner at the top. And they just come straight down. They don't spiral around at all. But they're the largest gems on the object. Again, it's a natural object, but it's an object which has been adorned with gems by the elfin themselves. So they've taken a natural form and embellished it with the gems, which are really quite widely available on the surface of Shemistra. They just really have to be gathered up. So there we have the first one. And you can see it almost hasn't got an outline. The outline is the other gems itself. So let's start with we're starting at the top left rather than at the bottom here, so I don't catch it. And the gems must therefore be flatter at the bottom, teardrops going to a point. Like so. I have to really concentrate to get them flatter at the bottom when I'm moving this way. And again, the edge of the object is the gems on the edge. Perhaps a little space in between can be filled with a line. Because it's on its side, I really have to think about the fact that it's the bottom of the gems which are fatter. So just because it's lying on its side, don't forget that it's the fatter parts of the gems move towards the base. It's more natural to do it the other way around, actually, when they're on the side, but that's not how they work. They should come towards it. More of a point, not an absolute point at the top, the teardrops. You can see how the perspective affects them. You see, as they move around to the edge, there's more of a curve on the top of the gem, slightly flatter on the bottom. And then the very edge, it's just a series of little U-shapes to give us an irregular edge. You might occasionally put a flat bottom on some of those right at the edge, like so. And then we go around with round ones, so these are round gems, smaller, around the base of the dome, like so, almost going, because we're seeing almost around there because of we're looking down on the dome. And then smaller oval ones forming the spirals. And again, you can see that I'm not fixed at all by my drawing beneath. I'm guided by it, but in no way limited by it. And then we have these holes. So that one should be in the middle. So put this one we're seeing side on, so it's almost just a line. And then we have this curling stem. Let's just make this one a hook shape. Oh, let's put a little bit of a curly cue on it. Just for interest. There we go. That's our forgettal dust, and we're going to have some of this one, because it's on the side, we're going to have some falling out onto the surface, but we'll do that with the colour itself. So there we are, we've completed our sketch pad with many of the things that Webstrand carries with her and wears on her costume, and we're now ready to turn these into colour. Pop over to the dedicated Elphen Chronicles channel on Vimeo to watch our growing collection of free-to-stream, behind-the-scenes bonus features, trailers, reveals, and more. including this peek over my shoulder as I paint Webstrand addressing her gathering swarm. The two shakers for the Remember and Forgettle Dust. Well, I've again applied the masking fluid there. Just tiny little highlights to all of those little bead gems around their surface. But now we're going to use the colour that we've mixed for a slightly different effect. We are going to create volume now. So I'm going to imagine that on these two objects, the light is coming from the right hand side. That's going to cast a shadow on the left. But we want to create as much contrast as possible. So in the background here, where the object is light on the right hand side, we're going to make the background darker. Where it's dark on the left hand side, make the background lighter. This is giving the objects the most contrast that we can do. And as an artist, this is the way you create the maximum of light. So it's all about contrast. In terms of painting, it's what's known as counterchange. Light against dark, dark against light. And artists throughout the ages have used this to create light throughout their paintings. And so we're going to use that on our Remember and Forgettle Dust. Exactly the same mix as before, just re-wetted with some water to make it fluid again, because it dries out so quickly, especially in a warm studio like this. And again, wetting the whole of that area at about 2 inches beyond, I always think. The background then. The light is coming from the right hand side, so we want to create the darkest background on the right, because the right hand side of the objects is going to be lighter. So dark there, and then ease off the pressure as we come round onto the left hand side, like so. Then the objects themselves can be darker on the left, and squeezing my brush, just pull the colour around to get some volume. If this is still wet, then you can bring some shadow out from the bottom of those two so that they stand firmly on the ground. If they're still wet, you can return to these and put a little bit of shadow over these gems on the left hand side, so that again it feels as if the light is falling on them from the right. And that gives them a little bit of volume. We've got some light and volume already. We can, of course, enhance that with our subsequent washes, but we've got to start. We've got a feeling that they're round, a feeling that there's light on them. The shakers for the Forgettle Dust and Remember Dust are coloured differently. That's not a natural colour. The Elphen colour them so that they don't forgettle which colour, which pod is which, because of course one dust makes you forget and one dust makes you remember, so to mix them up would be catastrophic. The Forgettle Dust pod is blue, and so once again use a different blue. As you can see, I've got three blues and this is the third blue. This is a cool blue, the blue-green, and that will show up well against the background blue, which is important. So we're going to put this on wet on dry, and we're going to start with the darkest mix. In fact, I'll use a slightly smaller brush for this because it's quite a small area. We're going to start with the darker mix on the darker side of the pod and simply fill these in. So that will be naturally dark I can then add some water at the edge of the mix. Now, if you're mixing on a palette like this, it's quite difficult to see that that's lighter, but as soon as you put it on the surface, you will start to see it lighten up. So we lighten up again, add more water. So another way of creating gradation, gradually to add water to the mix. We've already got a gradation underneath there, of course. Lighter again. Notice how I'm moving outward from my mix to control how light that becomes. Lighter again. Like so. And finally, a lot of water just to give this a very light edge where it's getting full light, like so. Swiftly clean this off. That then is the forgettle dust, which is blue. The remembled dust is a purple. So now we're taking the blue purple, which is going to make a bright purple, and we're going to go through the same process. There's my mix. The darkest one then, down here. In the shadow, which is helped by the colours beneath. Add some water to the mix. Again, I'm using two brushes. I'm using a big brush for mixing, which carries a lot of water. Or it would take me a long time to do that with a smaller brush. A little more water. You can see how the underlying colours really help to enhance this roundness, this volume. They come through. As long as you don't overwork the surface, you just lay the colour on swiftly. I think I can take that through to that next one. And it still looks lighter because the colour beneath it looks lighter. And then more water. So we're almost at pure water now, just a tiny bit of colour in that. Just for the far right hand side. So there we go. Now, moving back to the blue mix for the stems, which curl around like so, and they're blue in both cases. Those can be just painted in solidly. They're so fine. Don't go over the edges I've just done. And if you do, of course, you've got to lift it off again. There we go. Now, the little gems in there are around the... each of those have a little bit of masking fluid on. I think you can see the masking fluid. Those little bits of light there are masking fluid. And these are just a slightly darker version of what we already have. So I'm going to just mix with a small brush because I don't need a big mix here. Just a very small brush to just pop these on. And preferably, it's slightly difficult painting it so much to the left. Let's try and get them on the gems and not on the background. And because you've got the highlight on there, and because these are so small, they can just be painted in quite solidly. And they're the same colour all the way through. Because these are gems that have darkness within them. And they go around the dome at the top. And then the purple then, and a darker mix again. These can be slightly richer colour, these can be really rich colours. No yellow in this purple. Slightly on the red side, this purple. And then this dark colour again on each of the gems. You can take your time with them. I'm going fast there. And because I'm doing that fast, quickly, I'm making mistakes, which I've got to correct. So take your time with these. They're a delight to do. Well, I'm doing them quickly because they're relatively easy, because we're just blocking on solid colour. With the contrast against the lighter purple around them is what we want. It's like a little accent, which makes the lighter colours look brighter. And strangely, I think you'll notice adding these little accents just again brings more light into the painting. Going back to the idea once more that to create light you have to have darks. And that's what these little dark accents are doing, they're giving the accents. Finally, right in the centre, we'll use some of this again. The blue green with a little bit of red in it. That's going to give us a very, very dark blue. Keep it on the blue side, don't take it to grey. These are holes. Now, these particular seed pods don't hold forgettle dust. They come from the forgettle nettle and the remember rose, but the elfin use them, reuse them. Again, the recycling naturally occurring seed pods, and they put in the pollen from those two plants so they can sprinkle them easily when required. So there we have the remember dust and the forgettle dust, different colours, different coloured gems, ready to be used by the elfin, and we've got some volume on them and we've got some light ready for the masking fluid once more to come off. In this box set of 8 videos, I not only show you how to paint Webstrand, I also show you how to get her wings right when they are fully open, paint Webstrand's tooth gatherer's pouches, elegantly capture her elongated fingers on which she wears her swarm leader's eye ring, get familiar with the forgettle and remember dust shakers, which hold the elfin secrets. I've lifted the masking fluid from the forgettle and remember dust pods, and they look fine. I don't want to do any lift off at all. The only place that you might do lift off if you want to is if your pods are not light enough down this face, but mine certainly are. I do think the only thing I want to do is create a little bit more contrast. Now this is interesting because I'm going to create light by creating dark. By putting dark behind these two pods, the edges of themselves will start to look brighter. So I've mixed this colour again, the background colour, and the first thing I'm going to do is just with this brush, just wet this surface out here, and with a smaller brush come in with the colour of the background. Let's put a little bit more water in that so it flows more easily. Just bring that down the edge like so, and then we'll use the larger brush, in fact, with a little bit of water in it to just pull that colour out from that edge. So there's no hard edges on the outside. Take it all the way out. Keep going, adding more water. Remember how easily these outside edges dry with a hard edge. And that really is almost it. The only thing I want to do is just bring that dark just down here. And once again with a big brush, just pull that out. This hadn't been wet, so that edge is starting to dry. Just bring a bit of water in, float it out. And that's just, you can see the pods now look brighter because of the dark colour behind them. So it's a situation of counterchange, the light side of the pod against a dark background and the dark side against a light background, and we get the maximum effect of light within our study. Catch up with Webstrand the Tooth Gatherer and her newly met Earthling companion, Fizz, as they journey through the Starway to Shemistra, where they embark on a critical mission to Arctura and the Jade Lake. All is revealed in the 9 chapter videos of my artist edition Video Storybook.